and loads of volume of fluid replacement or resuscitation, they will develop this kind of complication. So limiting the amount of fluid administration may decrease the risk, but sometimes you need it, so you need to prioritize things sometimes. See what really is, like, weigh the pros and the cons of the situation, see what are the, weigh the risks and the benefits whenever you want to decide about this. Of course, your physician. The type of fluid is of no consequence. Sometimes some physicians, they say if we give colloids like albumin, for example, it will not cause that much problems. But unfortunately, literature says the use of colloids or crystalloids like saline and albumin will not be of great difference. So volume administration sometimes weighing, as we told you about the benefits and the risks, it improves cardiac output, renal flow, urine output, visceral perfusion, and sometimes it negates the negative effects of PEEP, because sometimes you have to set high PEEPs on such patients on the mechanical ventilation. And you know the problem with high PEEPs, it will decrease the cardiac output. So if you give fluids, you might overcome this problem sometimes. Of course, under hemodynamic support, if your patient's blood pressure is on the low side, we need to start them on inotropic support as well, or vasopressors, like norepinephrine infusion, epinephrine, or dopamine infusions. It depends on the situation and on the indication. Surgical decompression. What do we mean by surgical decompression? Again, we said the abdomen is really distended. It needs to be decompressed. So number one, we talked about like ways like invasive decompression, like putting an NG tube. But sometimes we have to go for the surgical option. If it's not going down, we have to do the surgical decompression. What we mean by that is the abdomen prior to development of ACS is becoming increasingly common and may improve survival. So we have to take the patient to OR. They have to open his abdomen in order to release the pressure exerted over the internal abdominal organs. And usually we go for this option if the intra-abdominal pressure is more than 25 millimeters mercury. Again, this is not like for everybody, it's just like general, because as I told you, some patients might have their intra-abdominal pressure higher than other people. But in general, above 25 millimeters mercury, we are afraid that the patient might go for ACS or abdominal compartment syndrome. So prophylactically, surgical decompression might be considered. Most surgeons also perform decompression and then maintain the abdomen open using temporary abdominal wall closure. So this is one of the pictures for one of the patients, like how to maintain, for example, just open the abdomen to release the pressure and keep it open. This is another picture. Hope you had your breakfast earlier. This is the way they do it sometimes. They open the abdominal wall and keep the organs, of course, cover it in order to avoid drying of the intestine, because it will further worsen the ischemia if it becomes dry. So this way they keep it up until they sometimes fix the problem or the patient's condition is better, then they will close it. I'll give you a quick idea about an open abdomen as well. An open abdomen is usually an abdominal wall defect created intentionally, leaving an abdominal incision open at the completion of surgery. They don't close, so they keep it open. When do we use an open abdomen? Usually in damage control surgeries, where the abdomen is left open to facilitate re-exploration sometimes in certain situations. As we just talked about the ACS or the abdominal compartment syndrome, we might leave it open. In septic abdomen, in cases of bowel perforation, you hear a lot about perforated appendix or in appendicitis or in traumatic situations where you have a perforated bowel. Usually it results in the contamination of the peritoneal cavity, ending up having septic abdomen. This is another indication. And refractory intracranial hypertension. As we mentioned earlier, in the latest stages of abdominal compartment syndrome, it might affect the intracranial pressure, ending up in severely elevated intracranial pressure, which is even more dangerous than the intra-abdominal pressure. So sometimes we do some interventions to fix it. If it doesn't resolve, then we need to, especially if the patient is having problems with his abdomen, then we need to think of doing an open abdomen if the intracranial pressure is refractory or is not responding to treatment, in other words. Of course, like any other surgeries, it has complications. If we leave the abdomen open, the patient might have more fluid loss, more protein loss, and it is estimated as 2 grams of protein lost usually from an abdomen for each liter of fluid removal. Sometimes unexpected fistulas might form, intercutaneous or interatmospheric fistulas. Loss of domain. Sometimes they try, after they open the abdomen, like I showed you a while ago, if they open this abdomen, sometimes, imagine this abdomen, how big is the incision. Now, if they want to bring it back to normal, it is usually difficult to bring it back to normal, ending up in what we have, loss of domain. They cannot bring the edges back together, ending up in this case. As you can see, the wound is still there, or the opening, but they maybe put a mesh or something to cover, or they use their creativity. So far, so good.
Yeah.
Almost finishing. We're almost finishing. Just to give you a quick idea about the nursing care, also. The major, one of the major nursing diagnoses is an effective cerebral tissue perfusion. As I told you, because of the cerebral edema, the patient's level of consciousness might be affected, vital signs, we're not going to go into the details of this complication, but it's a very, very dangerous complication if the patient has his intracranial pressure very high. It's going to end up in life-threatening complications. Some of these complications might be brain herniation or loss of consciousness, loss of lots of vital organs functions. So we have to be careful to these early signs and symptoms and alert the physician about it. Altered gaseous exchange or due to acidosis as well, as I told you, lungs are going to be one of the vital organs that are going to be compromised with an increase in the intra-abdominal pressure because of the limited space in order to mechanically ventilate the patient. The best option how to deal with this, basically to take care of the patient position in order to decrease the pressure exerted by the abdomen on the diaphragm. So keep the patient in supine. Make sure you sedate him. To relax him down, to calm him down. Use some paralytic agents in order to paralyze his muscles, not to exert. And of course, prevent complications basically resulting from mechanical ventilation like VAPS, ventilator-associated pneumonia, and the other stuff. Altered peripheral tissue perfusion. We said also, like in case the patient has wounds, we have to promote the healing for that wound, make sure nutritional wise. Basically, it's because of the altered blood supply to that wound. So basically, we have to work on maintaining the blood pressure for the patient in this case. How do we maintain the blood pressure for the patient? Is basically by giving fluids, as we just mentioned, maintaining the mean arterial pressure within the expected range by inotropic support and vasopressors, avoiding complications, decreasing the blood pressure like sepsis or dehydration, or other factors affecting the blood pressure. We'll have to be use our critical thinking in the ICU, and we have to maintain all of these things in addition to the things that we can do to the wound itself in terms of the wound care, maintain the dressings, change the dressings frequently, give antibiotics, etc. Impaired renal function, as we mentioned, also one of the vital organs that are affected with this is due to the pressure on the renal arteries, renal blood supply decreases, ending up in renal failure. How do we go about this? Basically, is sometimes it depends on the stage of the renal failure. Sometimes they might jump right away to, as I told you, dialysis, putting the patient on continuous renal replacement therapy, or giving diuretics, giving fluids, fluid boluses or challenge sometimes to improve the urine output, doing some scans to see what's happening, whether like an ultrasound for the kidney, or putting some drainages, etc. Altered bowel motion. As I told you, due to the bowel edema, intestinal wall edema, the peristaltic movement shuts down or goes down, ending up in sometimes in paralytic ileus, or you know, the patient doesn't move his bowels anymore. So basically what we can do is just try to give some laxatives, try to improve the bowel edema basically by limiting, sometimes it depends on the situation, as I told you again, either decreasing the fluids or restricting the fluid intake, putting the patient MPO for that period, putting him on replacement, IV replacement, like a total parenteral nutrition, or IV fluids. What we can do basically also, give some agents like we mentioned earlier, to enhance or stimulate the peristaltic movements, like domperidone and metoclopramide, rectal tubes, enemas, in order to aid and help the patient with moving his bowels. Sometimes also depends on the patient's situation and how stable he is. We might do some range of motion or consult physiotherapy on this, because moving the patient also sometimes might help stimulate the peristaltic movement. Risk for DVT, usually ICU patients, we put them on a prophylactic deep vein thrombosis medication right away. Once they come to the ICU, usually we put them on either heparin sub-Q, or we put them on what we call sequential compression device in order to avoid this complication and help decrease the venous stasis in the lower extremities. Again, be careful for the signs and symptoms of deep vein thrombosis, like calf swellings, positive Hohmann's. Do some range of motion, consult physiotherapy, put some elastic band, some elastic stockings. Actually, even sometimes some hospitals, they don't have the facilities like the SCD or the sequential compression device, so we put elastic stockings in order to help with this. Altered fluid and electrolytes, of course, we have to be careful for the fluids and the electrolytes, especially with acute renal failure. We have to be very careful for especially some electrolytes like hyperkalemia. And usually it is, we have to be experts with the interpretation of the electrocardiogram to see signs of hyperkalemia or other electrolyte imbalances, and do the appropriate interventions and alert our physicians. We have to advocate for our patients. Last but not least, if any of the complications are happening, especially like inability to bring the wound back to normal, it might create an impaired self-image, so we have to support the patient in that sense. Thank you for listening. Today's wisdom is, the only time you mustn't fail is the last time you try, for Charles Kettering. I hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any questions, we'll take it within the next 10 minutes.
Hello? Any question? Let's go region by region. We'll open the regions. Any question from Al-Konfuda?
Zan.
None? Thank you for listening to us. Any question from Namaz?
No, we don't have.
All right, and moving to Tabuk. Any question from Tabuk? Tabuk, any question? Do you hear me? Hello, in Tabuk. Any question? I can see your hands, but I cannot hear you at all. Can you turn the mic on from your side, please? You turned the light off, and I need the mic on also. All right, go to Najran. Any question from Najran?
No question.
All right, thank you so much all for listening. Don't forget to fill out the evaluation sheet and give it to your coordinator in order to get the CME hours. The other thing, if you have any interest for any future topic, just communicate with your coordinator and they will communicate with me to make sure that we are delivering whatever you would like to get a benefit of. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in the next session in December.
Inshallah.
Thank you. Bye.